spectrum, and that's about speeding up the energy transition. We in September had a launch here in The Hague of the Climate Action Hub. So climate and energy are really hot topics at the moment. So it's timely to talk about urban energy, and then we can think of a better guest than Henk Fischer. He's a professor of housing quality and process innovation at the faculty architecture at TU Delft. You have a very positive title, Delivering a Carbon-Free Urban Energy System in the Netherlands. So we're going to deliver it. So looking forward to your story. How is this going to work? I think you're going to talk like half an hour or so. Then we have a possibility for Q&A. For everybody, if you have any question, you can ask anytime you want. And for the online community, you can, of course, ask your question via the chat. And the question will be asked here.
Okay.
Frank Fischer.
Yeah, thank you for your introduction. Thank you also for the invitation to give a lecture here. Say something about our Urban Energy Institute at TU Delft, because that's also where I've started as a director since lately. And there we work on a bunch of topics related to the challenges that we face to deliver a carbon-free urban energy system in 2050. The word challenges is maybe missing in the title, because we're going to work on it, but there are tough challenges. So I was rightly introduced. I work in the Faculty of Architecture in the Built Environment. And also since a few years, I'm working on an innovation platform in the Netherlands, where we bring government, building industry, and knowledge institutes together to see how we can speed up innovation for all the various challenges in the built environment. So it is indeed the climate targets. It's not only use of energy in the user phase, it's also, say, going towards a circular built environment, and the use of materials, and also the CO2 emissions related to building, etc. There's also the challenges of climate adaptation. When the climate is changing, we have to adapt the built environments, more water, more heat, more longer rain, more water to get away with in the built environment. So we have to adapt our buildings for various reasons. But in our Urban Energy Institute, we focus in the first place on the challenges. And that is, of course, like it's defined to meet the climate agreements of Paris to reach the goals in 2050. CO2-free built environment. And also on the shorter run, we have also very fast, very, very severe goals. Today, we got a new plan of next government in the Netherlands, presenting the plans. Recently, or in the past few years, they said 2030, we want to save 49% CO2 emissions. Europe said recently, you have to speed up. It should be 55% CO2 emissions. I read from the news that the Netherlands wants to be ahead of this, say maybe it's not enough to meet these targets, so let's go for 60%. Okay, in 2030 is very short term when you look to the built environments, because it takes a lot of time to adapt new technologies, changes, etc., to build new buildings with new goals, and also to renovate our building stock. The built environment is a huge challenge because it has so many different actors that play a role and have to all build to work together. So that's more or less the environment we work on in our Delft Urban Energy Institute. And the Urban Energy Institute is a collaboration between different faculties, where we bring all the different specialists together to think about how are we going to contribute with our research and our education, and also how can we join forces for big research projects. So I have a long presentation with a lot of details. I'm not going to explain all the details in all the slides. The slides will be provided, so you can find more of the details maybe later, And if there's questions or you find anything, well, you can put it in the chat maybe for questions and answers. We try to answer it. And otherwise, later you find maybe possibilities to reach us. So some years ago, say 3-4 years ago, we got together with the group of specialists and we were thinking like, what are the main themes that we are good at CU Delft, but that are also very necessary. And sometimes you find the specialist in one faculty, but most of the times you find the specialist in the themes in more faculties. And we thought like, okay, built environment, urban environment, we have to look what we have to do on the level of the buildings, on the neighborhoods, maybe districts, and also the city level. Yeah? That's how we defined our levels. And we also defined 6 themes. And for every theme, there's a theme leader, the principal investigator. And also we defined our goal that we want to strive for. So the first theme is towards zero energy buildings and beyond. So how to improve the buildings for so they are future proof. Theme 2 is the fast transition of the existing building stock. I will come back to these themes later. Theme 3 is thermal urban energy systems. You know, at least in our climatic circumstances, heat in the built environment is taking most of the energy. And of course, we wanted to reduce the heat demand by insulation. But at the same time, we also want to find ways to get more sustainable heat that is available sometimes, like the geothermal heat. And other type of heat. So we want to deliver heat in the right place, in the right time, at the right temperature. Most of the heat yet nowadays is still produced on a very high temperature, like 90 degrees, when we burn our natural gas. But from other sources, it's sometimes from a lower heat. But then we also have to adapt the systems in our buildings so that they can provide enough comfort from a lower temperature. Theme 4, solar urban. So how to integrate PV in the whole built environment. Theme 5, smart monitoring, management and control. I will go more in depth into these themes later. And the 6th theme is transforming the cities. No? So a little bit more on these themes. So now we have a lot of details that I'm not going to mention all individually. The buildings, of course you can do most with what we built new. Then you can design it from scratch and you can find the right orientation and the way to have enough profit of PV panels, for instance, on a building. You can build with very good insulation with and meeting all the other requirements. And it's not only reducing heat demand because of higher temperatures, more insulation sometimes. And if you don't do the design right, you get overheating in the building at that time. And at the same time, the temperatures are rising. So instead of the heat problem, you might get a cooling problem. So this needs a very tuned design. Also, acoustical comfort might come in place when you insulate buildings very well. For instance, in renovation, when you have old houses and you insulate only the outside, then suddenly you can hear your neighbors very well. That can be another new annoyance. Or when you have ventilation systems that don't work well, can also give a lot of noise. So There's much more to do than only reduce the heat demand. Let's keep it by this. And then, of course, when we have defined these themes, we also started up a lot of projects, sometimes with collaboration with different faculties, also with external parties, with companies and governmental parties or municipalities or building owners. So I'm also presenting some of these projects that we are started up and still working on. And this, for instance, is an example of high level of renovation to make a building, an old building, which was built in the 1960s, 70s, to make it climate neutral. Yeah, with adding new facades, with adding PV, with changing the heat system. So this one is called Second Skin. There are more examples. In our institute, we're working on many different of these concepts. Then the second theme, the fast transition of the existing building stock. You have to be aware that if we're talking about goals of 2050, that most of these buildings in 2050 are the existing buildings. Yeah? We only built, at least in the Netherlands, in China it's a bit different, but at least in the whole of Europe, we add something like 1% of the existing stock with new ones. Yeah? So if you only focus on high-tech, new, climate-proof buildings, you're never going to reach your targets. So also in the climate agreements in the Netherlands, severe goals were set for how to speed up the renovation. And actually there was made a calculation that after a few years, we have to speed up until 200,000 renovations per year. And if you compare it with new builds, which is something like 70,000, then it's an enormous challenge. Huh? Not only for the investments, but also looking to the building industry, like where do you find the capacity in the building sector, in the construction sector? And so besides just doing it and finding money and the availability, you also have to change the production, maybe more to prefab, more automation, etc. That's also for new builds. So there's also lots of challenges for renovation. Especially in renovation, the big challenge is, of course, to get also the owners of buildings and the occupants of buildings involved and enthusiast and cooperative. Even for housing associations, which are big in the Netherlands, they still have to get agreement of their tenants before they can have a severe renovation project. So this is a big project. And then individual homeowners, even if they would have enough money to invest in their houses, they should also be willing to invest it. You can also spend it on other. And of course, there's many households that even cannot find enough money to do this. So I said to you about the new plans of the government. There will be many incentives, subsidies, etc., to get this train more going. So this is also a big challenge that we face in our Urban Energy Institute. And some years ago, we were happy to be able to start a huge national project with national innovation funds. And we call it IEBB, Integrale Energietransitie Bestaande Bouw, where we integrate or where we work on all these different issues that are necessary to change our existing building stock. Ranging from new renovation concepts, like the second skin, to new heat pumps that are cheaper, smaller, more silent, better to be used by the people, innovative processes, heat, all these different issues. And I think we had something like 125 different parties integrated with a total budget of 20 million euros. And we're still working on this. And this makes it able to combine these different issues, heat pumps with enthusiasm of people and housing associations that want to integrate it in their processes. Another project, which is very, very useful. In some plans of the government building companies, etc., they only think like existing buildings should be energy neutral. But it is a huge challenge. When you want to make them energy neutral, you think probably on like the Second Skin project, complete new facades, different energy system, etc. But for on the dwelling level, it's huge investments. So what we also do is look to where can we be maybe more efficient and effective. What is the needed level temperature of heat that can be used for existing, say, radiator systems to still get enough comfort? And when you have a lower temperature heat, it's easier to provide from district heating or geothermal heating. So that's the called LT ready project, low temperature ready. What do we have to do in the buildings to make them accessible or adaptable for low temperature heating? So not mentioning all these details, otherwise it's going to be too much detailed information. Go to the third thing, the thermal urban energy systems. So far in the Netherlands, we make use of geothermal heat, but it's available in many more places. There are various systems, very deep geothermal heat with high temperature, but big investments, or lower sources where you can also, and these sources you don't only use to take the heat to heat the buildings, but you can also use it as an, say, a kind of heat battery to store the heat when you don't need it in the summertime, and you can get it back in the wintertime. And you can also use it for cooling. Yeah. So that's also a specific theme. And then also all the networks that you need for district heating, where to develop this, what is the source of the heat to make it sustainable, et cetera. So there's also a huge national project defined, it's called Warming Up, taking into account all these different challenges and subjects with many parties, with the researchers, the regions, I think, that use it, and also the companies that should provide the heat. The fourth theme is solar urban. So, you know, PV panels, you can nowadays they are very cost effective for homeowners. You can install them on your rooftop. It's kind of easy, but a lot of people also think maybe it's ugly. You destroy the old nice view on city things. But it could be also much more integrated in the built environments on all different areas. That's also where this group is looking to. So to make much more use of the built environment, not only on rooftops, but maybe included in facades, or even there are now a cycle paths with PV in integrated. And then of course, there's also the challenge to make the PV more efficient, more effective, higher. So there's also a lot of projects for the innovation of that. The fifth theme, smart monitoring, management and control. The available energy for buildings, we should use them as effectively as possible. And we should be aware that we don't overuse heat. That's just as simple that as we leave this classroom, that we switch off the lights. That's a simple thing. But you can do it on many levels, of course. And in bigger buildings like this building, there will be an energy monitoring system. But these systems need a lot of more innovation to become smarter, so that anywhere where you can save energy, you do it in an effective way. So that needs sensoring, but also steering, etc. Also for this, we managed to set up a very big project. Miriam, here available, was more or less the designer of this project, but also many, many parties being involved. The engineering companies that make the systems, building owners, researchers, etc. So also this is touching on these many subjects in this area. And then in the cities, everything come together. The heat networks, so the generation of energy, the renovation of buildings. We can think more of exchange of energy between buildings. We went to a nice project in Amsterdam where data centers are located close to areas where people are going to live. The data centers, they produce a lot of heat, which is just going into the atmosphere. But you can also capture it and use it for a heat network. So these are interesting solutions for a city. So on a city level, there have been projects developed to make a good map of where energy is used, in what form, for what purpose, and where energy can be produced or is produced. And not just energy, but sustainable energy, of course. And that has to be in a smart design put all together. For instance, this project, City Zen project, they made this plan for Amsterdam, where they made inventories of where energy is needed and where it can be produced and what can be the ways to a sustainable transformation. So these were the themes and also some of the big projects that we are nowadays working on. The Urban Energy Institute is not only doing these projects by the theory and labs, but we also have some connections where we try it out in practice or maybe on a larger scale. So the hop, step, jump approach. It starts with the projects like I presented. Then in Delft, we have the Green Village with some nice examples of innovative potential solutions that are not yet on the market, but are tried out. So companies are invited to bring their experiments there. It can be used by students, it can be used for research. There's a picture in the next. And then we also try to build a pilot, find pilot locations. And for this, for instance, we have good connections with Amsterdam. There is the AMS, Amsterdam Metropolitan Solutions Institute. And they, together with the municipality of Amsterdam, in Amsterdam Southeast, have defined a kind of living laboratory where, along with real projects, also research is done and a place is there for innovations. And then, of course, the solutions are implemented, hopefully, in the market. So one more picture of the Green Village here. It's called a field lab for sustainable innovations. Have you ever been in Delft? Everybody knows about a Green Village, okay? But people online, maybe, if you come to Delft, make a visit to the Green Village. There are really nice innovations. And for instance, for our theme, what is nice is you see here these three houses that were originally typology of the 1970s, which we have a lot of them in the Netherlands. They are built there on site with new bricks, with new materials, but really in the same style as we have them everywhere. And there they can be used for all kinds of innovations of how to renovate these buildings with new energy systems, with insulation, etc. And then people can live there and feel the comfort, and a lot of research can be done around it. So this is a map of the Amsterdam Southeast area, where quite some examples of nice urban energy transitions are going on. So we try to build up new big projects and work together with the different faculties, but also with many parties outside that. We also have one of our core activities is online lectures like this. We invite people from our own university, but also many from outside. Once a month, nowadays, again, mostly or only online, but other times when it's possible, also in the faculty, we invite people to give a lecture of something that is very topical for the things that we're working on. The things, the presentations that have been done, they can still be viewed, I think, online. Yeah. And then we also organize workshops or symposia conferences. We've done it already a few years, mainly, yeah, with a lot of national parties being also involved, but it's always internationally presented around certain topics. For instance, we had recently, a few months ago, one on the LT Ready concept. And then with practitioners and researchers, we try to define the challenges that still remain. We also organize a international conference in April. It will be a live conference, not hybrid. So there we have a challenge. You can all join. You can sign up. The time for submission of abstracts is already finished. But besides presenting of scientific papers, there will be also many workshops. Workshops defined on all these issues that I presented here in my presentation today. What is also good to mention that in Delft, there is the union of students in this area. They call themselves the Energy Club, very active, not only on issues of urban energy, but also on the other fields of energy. Urban Energy Institute is one of the institutes in Delft under the whole energy initiative. There's also an institute on wind energy. There's also an institute on finding new energy generation, new refinery. There's also an institute on how to balance the whole electricity system called Power Web. These students, they stand for all these different issues of the Institute of Energy. And they organize, especially for students, also special events where they go to companies. And maybe to mention there is in the line of our symposium next year, or the symposium, not the, how to say it, our the celebration of the birthday of the university, the energy system, the energy theme. There's also a competition for papers, scientific papers. Papers that have been published already, they can be now submitted for this competition. So I think, and there's also, of course, education. In the area of Urban Energy Institutes, some MOOCs have been developed, so available for all of you. And of course, we also discuss on how to integrate new developments that we touch on in our research, how we get it better integrated in the educational system. So that were my slides. Hopefully I didn't take too much time.
It's an impressive portfolio of research, also in its depth, from buildings towards cities. It's interdisciplinary. It's also very positive. Well, I think it's necessary because, well, we need a 50% reduction of greenhouse gases. But just forgive me, I'm going to ask for a bit of a negative thing, so maybe something about barriers to that goal, 50% reduction. And my question is more like, what do you think are the main barriers? Are these technological barriers, like there's not enough innovation to get to that 50%, or maybe institutional barriers, that there are regulations in place, that are there's being barriers, or the market is not very fast, or maybe political barriers. What barriers do you see for this 50% reduction? With regard to the urban energy, of course. Huh?
Yeah. Now 50%. I think it's going to be increased. The government says now 2030, 60%. So even challenges are higher. When we look back 4 years ago, there was the climate agreement in the Netherlands installed with a lot of goals. And actually some of them we should already see emerging now. And I think on some levels, progress has been made, like wind on sea.
Yeah.
There you see really things coming off. I think the government can also do things with the industry, make it more sustainable. And that also has a big effect, because then, of course, it's always about a lot of investments and money. But if the parties that are involved are not too many, then the problem can be overseen and how to tackle. If you look to the challenge that I was talking about, besides technical innovation, of course we need technical innovation. PV can be more efficient, so you can do more with less. The technology in finding heat and make it available, that can also, there are a lot of technologies that can be more adequate, more efficient, etc., and also become cheaper.
Yeah.
Heat pumps, individual heat pumps for houses are extremely expensive. So there's also a kind of logical expectation. If the market increases, prices will go down. That will make things more easy. But the big challenge, of course, still is to get it implemented in the built environments, because there are so many parties that have a say in it. In the urban area, the municipality, the building owners, the building users, it's not always the same. Everybody has to agree. Nowadays, solutions are too expensive. It's also not so easy to find out what's the best thing to do.
Could be a subject of strategies, or what actors should be in favor, like architects or project developers, owners. What should be the order?
I think it starts with the government.
Government.
To provide clearness.
So that's the regulatory.
Yeah. Well, for instance, a thing that I did not mention is that one of the things of the climate agreement was the making of regional energy strategies, so that it becomes clear for all the regions what the energy provision, sustainable energy provision, would be and what it would require from buildings. Before, it wasn't there. It was unclear what strategy you would apply for changing the buildings. So that comes off now, I think. And but from now on, I think, everybody's looking like, what should I do? For instance, housing associations. They can make investments, but they also are looking like, I have to provide new houses for many people.
It's also comfortable to just wait for regulations.
Yeah. But you need, I think, and then what is also important, of course, is the costs and benefits, the cost of energy, the benefits of energy, CO2 pricing, etc. That can make a big difference. I think taxes in the hands of the government, they are something that can be used to make things more easy.
It could base itself, like 60% is huge reduction. Could the base itself be a barrier, because there might be lock-ins? We're talking about innovation, so you go to choose for suboptimal technology in order to make the 60%, but then on the long run you get problems.
Yeah,
maybe also these kind of lock-ins, do you identify them?
Well, for buildings, the saying of course is always, well, insulation is always good. But if you go to a building and you insulate it on a certain level, and in 10 years' time you find out, I have to go further, then you have to reinvest. And then it's not only the material cost, it's also the whole project cost.
Yeah.
So,
including production. So if you're talking life cycles, then in fact you have a suboptimal solution.
Yeah. But it's also not so easy to give good answers like where should we start with, because you could say like, well, let's wait until things got, the technical innovation gets further. Mm-hmm. It becomes cheaper. Well, it won't become cheaper if it's not used on a higher scale, where the market isn't. Yeah. Let's wait until the government give more clearance. But if we wait, then I told you about the calculation that was made, like 200,000 renovations per year. Mm-hmm. If you wait a few years, you don't find the building capacity to get it done. Huh? So we still have to find ways of projects that find a good balance between costs, reaching a fair share towards the directions, and seem to be a good investment on the level of the buildings to give them a good progress in the future.
That's economic challenges right there.
Yeah.
Are there any questions from the audience or questions online?
There are some questions online. Okay. Michiel asked a question. He asked, the new cabinet that was announced this morning indicates an intention to build at least 100,000 houses per year in the next decade. What challenges and opportunities do you see in this plan to build more sustainable building, which is supposed to target a lower price class?
Challenges and opportunities. Well, I think when we build a lot of new buildings, what I started with in my lecture, you have the chance to do it with our current insights to meet many, many challenges. If we build, for instance, more bio-based, wood-based, etc., the material impact will be less. And of course, you can make these buildings from an energy point of view as good as possible, because we can design it very good. And when we add a lot, then that also means that the balance for the whole stock becomes a bit better. The challenges are, of course, like when it has to go that fast, there's not so much time to do it in an innovative way, and maybe also take a lot of traditional solutions.
There's an optimum there. Eh? That's too slow. It's bad for innovation. Too fast is bad for innovation.
Maybe. Yeah.
Very nice. Yeah. Other questions online?
There's another question. What would be the expected outcomes of proposed energy labels in the Netherlands? Is there a possibility for energy labels for residential homes in the near future?
I don't know, just get a question. Can you say it again, how it's formulated?
Basically the question is if there's a possibility for energy labels for residential homes in the near future.
Well, all residential buildings do have an energy label. It already was in place in 2008, I think. Since then, we had different systems. Nowadays, if we build something new, it has to be nearly zero energy. So, the standards, how to calculate the energy use for a building, will be changed. So energy labels in the past years have had a good function in a way to get an indication like what quality of a building it has. It also sometimes was misused because it was not always a good indication of the real energy use because of the different behavior of people. You can live in an old, not insulated house, a very bad energy label, still not use very much energy, because you only heat your living room, etc. So the energy labels have had a good use, a good function, but also were sometimes used not in a very adequate way. Also, energy labels made a combination of energy demand of a building, like what is the insulation level, and also energy generation. So you could have a good energy label with bad insulation and many PV panels on your rooftop. So in that way, it's not a good indication for how future-proof the building is on the long run. So that's going to change. There's going to be now a kind of new standard, especially for insulation. So that it's, and maybe it's voluntary in the beginning, but in the longer run, it can become more mandatory. So in that way, there's more steering from the government to increase the level of insulation of buildings, existing buildings also in the longer run. I don't know if it's a good answer to the question, but
it's a different policy instrument then. Instead of the energy labels, which is a bit of a market incentive to be scarce with energy, or and you now go to into more regulatory style, like okay, this type of insulation, you try to make it obligatory.
Yeah.
Is that instead of the energy labels?
Yeah, it's kind of transformation.
Transformation.
Okay. Yeah.
So the bit of the end of the era of self-regulation, or what it was basically self-regulation.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, it was. And yeah, of course, it depends on what power a government has in different areas. Mm-hmm. So it's easier to say to in the Netherlands to housing associations that, yeah, to get. And one of the things they announced today that the housing association had to pay a certain tax, mm-hmm. for the huurdersbelasting, and that's going to be skipped. Yeah. But the government can say, like, well, then we require that you reach this insulation level, mm-hmm. In a few years' time.
This is also different means, like. We now know about energy use because there are smart meters, etc.
Yeah.
Is that a way to look at saving energy instead of via the materials?
Well, that would be smart, but of course it's a bit difficult for a government to... Yeah, you could also say like every household get a certain quantum of energy, mm-hmm. And if you use more, you pay much more. Mm-hmm. So if you want to avoid it, you can buy PV panels or you can insulate your building, mm-hmm. etc. But I think for the policy for a building stock is that is a long term view, and mm-hmm. the individual building users, owners or yeah. the people that live there, they change mostly after 10 years. Yeah. So if we all depended on behavior, it can be an added thing, but not the basic thing.
Okay. Any other questions?
Yep.
So sometimes now when we talk about like energy efficiency in the built environment and green buildings, a lot of people are really promoting more like international green building rating systems like LEED or BREEAM. So do you think that that is something that is useful to have, or should like countries just develop their own standards for how their buildings can be energy efficient on the green?
International standards are very useful, of course, because then circumstances between countries differ, but I think there are, yeah, such a labeling system is based on the standards. The standard is a way of how you calculate things. And that's a real scientific thing, in fact. So the environmental burden of building, that can be really done according to a standard. But what requirement is connected to this, what regulation, that might, yeah, there should be maybe more difference between countries to say like what is useful, how to use this way of calculating. So I was talking about energy labels. You're talking about BREEAM. The energy label is just talking about the amount of energy is used in the use phase. from year to year. A BREEAM label is saying more about the design quality and also including all the materials used. Yeah, so I think these kind of labels and standards, there is much of them in the world, and there will be a development to get it closer. If you have a look to Europe, in some way it's very much regulated on a European level. Like it says that every country should have a standard for nearly zero buildings, but it doesn't say what is the standard. So if you compare it over the 27 member states, nearly zero energy has a different explanation. So yeah, but that's a challenge. And I think for scientists, it's good to look to all these systems, and maybe we have a challenge to bring, say, the normative part of it, the standards, the calculation, more in connection to each other, so that we can all talk the same scientific language.
How do you see that as a methodological challenge to come to these standards, or just a semantic challenge, or maybe political challenge? I don't know, to harmonize these standards a bit.
How do you started your question? What is the main
challenge? There are various standards internationally.
Yeah.
Also, zero. What is it? Zero emissions. And energy use. So of course, then we ask people to harmonize them a bit, to make it to one international standard.
Yeah.
That is a challenge. Is it a methodological challenge, or how do we try to get to these zero? How do we try to calculate that? Or is that a political challenge? Like that means that some countries may favor one method over another, or maybe just a semantic challenge, just about language.
Yeah,
what kind of challenge do you see?
The main challenge, I would say, I mean, these are standards. If you have standards for a product, then the producers of the products can easily get together and say, like, this is the way we're going to calculate it. And then it's worldwide known how we do this. But if you're talking about buildings, there's a very local, national, cultural dimension to it.
Mm-hmm.
So I was mentioning this example of the energy labels. In Europe, they can think about how to uniform this. But when it's implemented in member states, the politicians face the building owners, the building industry, and a lot of political issues come in place. Like we had the energy labels, the system was changed in the Netherlands many times.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes there was a kind of favor of making it more secure, more content-wise solid, but then the price increase, and then you say a political party that wants to stand for the building owner say, well, it should be as cheap as possible. And it changes, and then after a while again, like, what's the use of this label? You have to. So there's a lot of influence from the policy, the politics of the use of these instruments.
Yeah.
And that can also influence, of course, like how much money there would be available to develop more uniform standards.
Yeah. Okay. Any other questions?
Yeah, there are some more questions online. Nice. There's someone watching from the University of Valencia, and they are wondering how do urban energy activities at TU Delft relate to what the city itself, so Delft and other cities, are doing in parallel on this subject?
Yeah, nice question. Well, I was already mentioning Amsterdam. There is an institute, and together with the municipality of Amsterdam, they are making and implementing plans there, especially in a town area. Sometimes there are projects also for a whole municipality like Amsterdam. I think Delft and The Hague could be good examples. Valencia can also be I mean, I showed you the example of the Zen. What was the name of the
Citizen
project? I think that such a project also develops tools and methodologies that can be used on a city scale. So such a European project it was, deliverables of that are always open things. So that can be implied. But yes, we are looking to work together with the municipality of Delft also for the heat grid, for instance. Also the campus of TU Delft is also part of our, not only the experiments, but also the implementation strategy. There is a plan for the whole campus in Delft, the university buildings, of how to integrate to a maximum level PV panels. We're making calculations of all the aspects of CO2 impacts, even until the food that we use in our canteens and the cafeteria of the Faculty of Architecture is, because of this, only offers vegetarian food. So that's also a contribution. So yes, we make plans for cities and other areas.
Okay. Other questions? You said questions. Yes. There was an S behind it.
There's one more question online. Someone is asking, how do you see the risk of overheating in a built environment in the Netherlands? And how should that be taken into account in the energy transition plan?
Yes, I touched upon this. The redesign of buildings should be very smart. It's not just putting more insulation to a building and reduce the heat, because part of the renovation strategy or also for new build is to make a building airtight. Yeah, because when air floats away, heat flows away. So when you make it airtight, you're very much depending on the ventilation system. So that should function very well. If you have a lot of glazing facing south, then it's very easy to get too much radiation heat inside, and you need a lot of cooling. So there is this danger, and we've seen lots of examples in practice already that it's not optimum. So you need a very smart design, including ventilation system and including like where's the glazing, and you have enough shading.
Well, let's, if there are no other questions, let's finish with a positive one. Elon Musk saying, well, we have technological solution for our climate problems, etc. Not everybody believes in, but okay. Is there any killer technology that you really believe in? Like, okay, this is going to help us.
No.
Have a positive.
But a positive thing is that I think the mindset of governments, building industry, people is getting much more supportive for the change that is needed. So I would say that is, when you looked at the urban problem, I said it's a problem that is touching many, many parties. And we have to all look to the same direction and see it as the way to go forward. And I think that is going better. And it starts with a positive, good government view on this. And it's not only the Dutch government that has severe climate plans. I think many other countries also do the same. That's my positive.
Okay,
I don't think there's one technical solution that saves everything.
Well, I like it. The mindset being, in fact, a condition for future technologies to find fertile ground. And it's an interplay between government and society, I guess, and which is first, we don't know. Well, thank you very much for your story and nice Q&A afterwards. I think we learned a lot about this entire research area, in fact, and we covered a lot of aspects, and we can go in depth into two methodologies, with the economy and technology. So there are lots of things to do. So that's what the Urban Energy Institute wants to do. So thank you very much for your story. Thank you also the audience, and thank you for the bosses and Ojan and Mels. We'll have a next webinar, January 19th, so already put that in your agenda, please. And then we'll see each other next time at the TU Delft The Hague webinar. Thank you.
3 recording, still recording.